Now, if you have Bible, I turn to James, and James chapter 3, I will bring a message out on tongues. James chapter 3, verse 6. The tongue is a fire. He says the tongue is a world of iniquity in James chapter 6, or James chapter 3, verse 6, and set on fire hell. And he says the tongue is unruly evil, full of deadly poison, no man can tame it. And I want to draw your fiction out about tongues and the Christian. The Bible has a lot to say about words, and the Bible thinks so much of words, the Bible even says, by thy words thou shalt be justified, by thy words thou shalt be condemned. And there's some things the Christian ought to know about words. Now, in the first place, look at chapter 1. About chapter 1, somewhere down about verse 19 there, there's a verse that says, wherefore let every man be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Is that 19? The first thing about speaking, and speaking too quickly, and that's what most of us do, is let every man be quick to hear, and slow to speak, and slow to speak, and slow to wrath. So sometimes you'll regret having kept your mouth shut. And I must confess there are times when, especially been witnessing, about witnessing, that I wish I'd said something when I didn't say anything. But by far the greatest odds in my life and your life are the time we open our big mouth when we wish we could have kept it shut. And for every word that you did not speak that you regret, you'll find you spoke 50 that you regretted. And he said, let every man be swift to hear, and then he said, let every man be slow to speak. Swift to hear, slow to speak. You open your mouth and you put your foot in it, as the expression goes. It's better to listen, carefully, and then think the thing over, and don't be too quick about it. I know us preachers talk a lot, and some of us preachers talk a lot, haven't thought very much before we say what we say. And then sometime we do. They asked an old colored woman one time, they said, how come you don't get in much trouble? I said, notice you don't talk very much, don't say very much, and when you do say something, it's pretty important. And she said, well, honey, child, she said, when I get my words on my tongue, I always just taste them before they come out of my mouth. And there's a lot of truth about that. Be swift to hear and slow to speak. Take your time on it. One time a young man was in a fraternity down there in the living room late at night. He was standing up making the ass out of himself, like most of them do. And he was up there talking about what it took to be a big-time operator and a big-time ladies' man, a big man on the campus and all this and that. And he was describing, you know, what it took to be a wolf, you know, and a big-time operator. And some of the details are pretty lurid. And after he'd gone on there for about 20, 30 minutes, and there was a silence there except for people chuckling and laughing and grinning, some Christian young man that had stayed there throughout the thing, and he'd stayed there, said, I think you left out two very important qualifications. And the fellow said, what? And he said, a weak head and a wicked heart. You're going to mess up that night, brother, see? But that's an old boy just sitting there just thinking, see? Just thinking. Then he says it. And that's how the Christian should be. You ought to pull back there and think about it, pray about it, and then put it in. One time an old man got in a cab going downtown. He had to share the cab with five or six young bucks heading for town, and they were going there to make a night in the town, going there and chat around, have a good time, and they got talking about what they're going to do and this and that, and they, one of them winked at the other one, turned to the old man, you know, and said to the old man, he said, wouldn't you like to join us, Pop? And that old fellow looked at them each right in the face, in the back seat and in the front seat, and said, gentlemen, I fear God. Looked back out the window. That'll do it, too. That's being quick to hear and slow to speak. And God's people should be that way. You open your mouth, like I said, and you put your foot in it. One time a lady just about had an accident. She tried to pass a bus on the hill and about hit a truck coming the other way and went off the road. And if the trucker hadn't driven his truck off the road, she'd have been a dead woman. And she was sitting there just sweating in a panic, about to have a heart attack. And about that time, the truck door opened. This big old boy got out and lumbered over there about 6 feet four and chewing a big old cigar. And weighed about 270 pounds, just mad as a bull. And she thought, oh, goodness, I'm in for it now. And he stuck his head in the window, that lady. And then she about had another heart attack, and he drew a circle around her head. And he said, lady, that's the way to make angels. And they went on back to his truck, you know. And, you know, that fellow was a wise man, you know. Instead of blowing his top and shooting off his mouth, making a fool out of himself, he just said a few choice words. Lady, that's the way they make angels. Back to his cab, brother. And you know something? That woman wouldn't forget that thing. She lived 1,000. You could never forget a thing like that. Every time you're driving down the road, that's the way they make angels, brother. So he says, let every man be quick to hear and slow to speak and slow to wrath. One time a man looked out the window of his house and he saw a fellow coming down the street with a garbage can. And the garbage can was on a wheelbarrow just filled with stuff. And the fellow came right up into his yard with it and started dumping on his flower bed. And the fellow in the house came out and he knew the man and he said, George, he said, what are you doing? What are you doing? He said, I came by here to dump this garbage. What do you want to dump? And he said, I don't want the garbage dumping my lawn. He said, this be a good place right over here. You got some flowers right in here. And, you know, eggshells and pieces of dead cat, you know, and dead fish and tin cans and razor blades and wrappings in there. And the fellow said, you fool, I don't want this stuff dumped in my garden. And he said, well, I'll put it where you want it. I brought it down here just for you. And he said, but I don't want it. Are you crazy? He said, take the stuff out of here. And the fellow said, well, he said, you've been dumping your garbage around. I just thought I'd dump mine around your place like you've been dumping around mine. And the fellow said, George, you must be out of your mind. I never dump any garbage around your place. That fellow put on the wheelbarrow and said, you know something? He said, I teach a class of junior boys in Sunday school. And he said, just the other day on the drugstore, he said, I heard you down there talking with those boys and telling them some dirty jokes. And I said, I've had reports to you in the past showing them dirty magazines, dirty pictures down at that drugstore. And he said, I've got some little plants I'm trying to make grow and trying to raise them right and trying to make beautiful plants out of them. And you're dumping garbage all over them. And if you have a right to dump garbage on mine, I got a right to dump it on yours. Where do you want this garbage? Well, he never dumped it. But, brother, he got it across. And the Lord, people should be like that. Wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove, quick to speak, slow to wrath. Or quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Take your time, and then when you say the thing, have it mean something. All right, the next thing about this tongue is, you must remember this, that God hears every word you say. Thou, Lord, seest me, is one scripture, and then there's another one that says, for every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. One time a salesman in a certain auto lot had a verse of scripture on the wall there, the little building, you know, they have on the car lot. And I've seen them like that. I've got a friend down in Panama City, a Christian used car salesman. And you might not think a fellow could be a Christian, be a used car salesman, but he is. And he has a sign there right on top of his door in front of there, and it says, let your yea be yea and your nay be nay. Oh, that's a hard thing, you know, for salesmen. And there was a salesman one time about to make a sale, and he had a little old plaque up there on the wall, and the plaque said, God hears every word I say. And he finished giving this fellow this sales pitch, and the fellow started to buy the car, and he bent over there and got the pen to sign the contract, and then he turned to the salesman and said, the question I want to ask you, he said, before I buy this, if you were me, would you buy this car? If you were my shoes? And that salesman looked up there and saw that thing up there on the wall, and his heart dropped down in his boots, and he needed the cut in the thing, needed the income, needed the commission. And it said, God hears every word you say. And he turned to the fellow and said, no, and lost the contract, lost the sale. Somebody, well, that's a terrible thing to lose money like that. Yeah, it's a terrible thing to lose your character, too. And it's a terrible thing to get where your word don't mean nothing. And when you say yes, folks know you mean yes. When you say no, folks know you mean no. He said, but if you or me, would you buy the thing? And the fellow said no. Somebody said he's a bad salesman. Yeah, but he's a good Christian. He's a good Christian. And so God hears all. God hears everything you say. One time a fellow, and he always did this, he prayed with his family. A fellow came downstairs and had breakfast with his family and said the blessing, bowed his head over the table and said, Lord Jesus, we thank you for this food and thank you for this coffee and thank you for this good meal and thank you for these biscuits and that, this and that and the hands that prepared them and bless our household and thank you for this beautiful day and so forth and so on. Amen. Quit. And then he got up and they got eaten, you know, and he got complaining about the toast being burnt, you know, and the eggs having too much grease in them, and the bacon not being cooked, you know, and there wasn't enough sugar in the coffee, and the coffee was cold. And when he got all through, one of his little boys sitting there said, Daddy, did God hear you when you talked to him? And he thought he was talking about the blessing, you know. And he said, why, of course. And he said, well, did God hear every word you said? And the daddy, thinking he meant talking about the blessing, said, yeah. And the little boy said, well, then which one did he believe? And the daddy said, well, what do you mean by that? He said, well, in the blessing, you were thanking the Lord for everything, and now it's all wrong. Which one's right? Good question, brother. Good question. God hears everything. God hears everything. The Bible says in the multitude of words that wanteth not sin. The Bible says the tongue is unruly evil, full of deadly poison. No man can tame it. No man can tame it. Of course, you have unintentional errors, and I know that. There's an old proverb out in the world. It runs, there's many a slip twixt the tongue and lip. And that's true. You have all kinds of errors. I was a radio announcer for years, and I know the kind of errors you can make. You can do some wild things, some crazy things. I appreciate that story about the two fellows at the dance. You know, one of them turns the other and says, who's that big fat slob over there? The other fellow said, it's my sister. That's rough, man. That's rough. And I don't know how many of those things you ever put your foot in, but I put my foot in a lot of things like that, brother. And especially back in the old days. And it's unintentional. It's just a slip. There's many a slip. The newspaper published an article one time and said, a defective was fired from the police force. A defective. And they asked them to change it, so they proofread it again and printed it again and said, a detective was fired from the police force. They got the thing wrong again. And there are those unintentional slips. And I know the Lord not going to hold you accountable or something like that. It just, you know, just comes out. You don't know what, you just miss, you know. And so that's one kind of slip with the tongue. But most of our mistakes, you know, are not, they're not intentional. Most of them are pretty well planned when they come through. There's a certain preacher, know it, went down to the fish market to get some fish and got down there and he said, the man in the market, he said, throw them to me. And the fellow said, throw them to me. He said, yeah, take them out of the window there and throw them to me. And the man said, what on earth for? He said, well, I won't tell people I caught them and I don't want to lie about it. And did you know that the human heart, deceitful above all things and desperately wicked? And you can rig up all kinds of things like that, you know. They put a fellow in the stand one time and they said, did you write that letter? And he said, no, I did not. And he told the truth. He dictated it. See? And people find that way. A politician got up one time and he said, when it comes to fishing and hunting, he said, I prefer Alabama to Ohio. And they put out in the newspaper, Senator so-and-so, or Congressman so-and-so, prefers Alabama to Ohio. See, they just cut the thing in the middle. And the tongue like that, speech is like that, it's treacherous. All right, the next thing about it is this speech, although a lot of things about it are funny, you couldn't count the homes that have been torn up, and you couldn't count the churches that have been torn up by a big old blabbing mouth. Christians do more harm to themselves than anybody else does. I'm convinced of that through the years. They do more damage to themselves and more damage to the cause of Christ than a dozen communists or 1,000 Roman Catholics or Bolsheviks or anything else. And they do it by just talking. The Bible says a hypocrite with his mouth destroys his neighbor. A hypocrite with his mouth destroys his neighbor. The Bible says in a multitude of words that wanteth not sin. The Bible says the tongue is a world of iniquity and set on fire of hell. A marriage counselor said one time, he said, the way to keep a marriage together is just every day, just forget to say three or four things you were going to say. Just every day, three or four of them, just don't say them. Just let the thing go. It wasn't that important anyway, and just forget it. And there's a lot of truth in that. A lot of truth in that. You ever hear boys and girls argue? You ever hear boys and girls say, is so, is not, tis too, tis not, is so, not either. Two children saying, tis, taint. Tis, taint, tis too, taint neither. And after they've been going that way, you know, for about 30 minutes, the mother stopped them and said, what in the world are you arguing about? And neither one of them knew what they're arguing about. I mean, they've been saying tis and taint for so long, they forgot what they're talking about. And did you know husbands and wives have those problems, you know? You get a thing going after thing been running kind of a running battle for 3 or 4 days, you know. You try to trace back where the thing was, and you can't find out what in the world the thing was. It's a fellow said it's like making a mountain out of a molehill, and a lot of truth in that. Man, those family arguments get going. They get going over a shoe left in the wrong place, see? Or a door slammed too hard, you know. Oh, look, it's the little foxes that spoil the grapes, you know. Or the wrong thing in the icebox. Or something out of the icebox that should have been in the icebox. Or a tool he couldn't find, you know, one of those jobs. And the thing just gets going, you know, and then the woman remembers something nasty he said a month ago in some other argument, you know. And then she gets kind of down and out about that thing, gets done about that thing. Then he begins to get suspicious. And then he begins to throw in some darts here and there. And then she thinks she doesn't love her. She begins to fight back. That thing gets going. And by after maybe 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, if you put the couple right down and said, now what started this? You get 15 different versions. You don't know where in the world the thing started. That Bible says the tongue is a world of iniquity and a set on fire hell. That Bible says leave off contention before it be meddled with. It's like water breaking through a roof and the hole just getting wider and wider and wider. And pretty soon you can't stop it. It tears up homes, tears up churches. One time a bunch of ladies were criticizing a lady in the church. And as ladies will do, you know, no, she's wearing this makeup, wearing that makeup and, you know, all painted up like a possum hunter in pokeberry time, all that business. They weren't saying that, but that's what they meant. And talking away like that, and finally the preacher had about it he could take of it. One day over here in the conversation, he said, well, I'll tell you one thing, ladies. I don't think it's any worse thing in the world for a sinner to redden her cheeks than for another sinner to blacken her character. And there's something to that, too. He says, a hypocrite with his mouth destroys his neighbor. In a multitude of words, there wanteth not sin. A fool's voice is known by a multitude of words. That tongue has problems. You say, what are you drawing here? Well, I'm drawing a hunter. And he has some arrows back here. And that's the name of his arrows. You might call them, rumors, too. Rumors sometimes are just like gossip. I've had people phone me up from all kinds of distance at all kinds of times and all kinds of occasions and circumstances and say, well, how are you getting along, Brother Ruckman? Just fine. Well, I heard you were in the hospital. Oh, you heard I was in the hospital. No, I'm just fine. Why? Well, somebody said you had a heart attack, you know, all that kind of stuff going around. You know, it's almost like they're saying, oh, good heavens, I hope you have had one or I've got the wrong information. You know the old joke, don't you? What happened when the boarding house blew up? Rumors were flying. And no bunch of people in the world, oh, you get it in a while. And no bunch of people in the world are noted for flying rumors like army men. They call it scuttlebutt in the Marines, in the Navy. Like army people and church people. And the trouble with church people is they get turning on themselves. See? To me, the greatest problem of God's people is how to work in a church together happily and successfully and joyfully and fruitfully, without getting so involved in each other in the church that you blow the thing all to pieces. God doesn't want his people turned in. He wants them to go out. And a church, as it stands, is a training center or a place for exhortation and a place for joy and a place for communion and fellowship where you get stirred up and strengthened to go out. Your interest is out there with the unsaved people. Your battle is out there with the world. This is your place where you get warmed up. This isn't the place where you shoot at each other. Oh, there it is. That isn't it. He says, the tongue is a world of iniquity and set on fire of hell. And he said, no man can tame it. Why, he said one time, he said, if a man can rule the tongue, he said, he can rule the whole body. If he can rule the tongue, he can rule the whole body. And that's quite something there. If a man can rule the tongue, then he can rule the whole body. All right, it breaks up home, it breaks up churches. I've heard of a lot of things, a little matter kindled and turned into a great big fire, but I believe the worst one I ever heard was a case, it appeared, it was written in Christian Life. In Christian Life one time, some lady sent in a true account of something that happened in a small town up north, and it was one of the most horrible things you ever heard of, and I can't remember all the details of it. But it seemed like there was a boy, and his name was Tom Jackson, and he had a drunken father and a Christian mother, lived out in the country, and he sold newspapers for a living, and he was a Boy Scout, and he belonged to one of these churches, or joined one of these churches, where you take confirmation courses, then you have your confirmation day. It was a Bible-believing church, but, you know, kind of high class. And one night at the Boy Scouts, some of the Boy Scouts said, "Looky here, what's this?" And somebody said, "What's that?" And they says, "Beer." And here was a beer bottle there. And then somebody said, "Well, where'd that come from?" One of the boys said, "Oh, I found it in Tom's car." And they all talking, laughed, and called Tom in and said, "Oh, you've been drinking, huh?" And he said, "No, I hate that stuff. I hate that stuff. Maybe my dad left it in there or something, but that isn't mine. I don't want it." And he drove his car on back and left it there, and the boys tried it out. And they tried out the beer, and then one of them went home, and his mother, somebody named Brown or something, said, "What's that on your breath?" He said, "Well, I've been drinking some beer." She said, "Where'd you get any beer at?" And they're all Christian boys. And she said, "Well, Tom Jackson bought some and gave it to us." And that woman had a fit. And she got in that telephone and phoned the pastor, then phoned the mayor, and said, "What kind of a Boy Scout you got down there where Tom Jackson's bringing beer in there from a drink? My boy came home and said he passed out bottles to all the boys. There are several bottles." And the mayor phoned the preacher up and said, "You got to see so-and-so, and they're taking these confirmation courses here. Church over here, Mrs. Brown said he bought a case of liquor down there tonight. She goes, boy, away she rolls." And so that thing went on, and pretty soon Tom Jackson's come to school. Nobody talked to him, move on away from him. Pretty soon his pastor said, "We're going to have to lay confirmation services for you." Pretty soon his boss said, "Sorry, Tom, we can't." And the boy would go to the mayor and try to talk it over, and the mayor would say, "If you don't straighten out, we'll have to send you off to state school." And the boy said, "But I didn't do that. It was just one bottle. I don't know how it got there. It was in the car. Oh, wait, Mrs. Brown says this, and Mrs. So-and-so said this, and all the ladies get together, you know, and four or five of the indignant mothers, blah, 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 boy, just putting them out, brother, putting them out." And pretty soon old Tom got down the dumps, and he couldn't get anywhere with his pastor and anybody else. And he said to his mama, "You go talk to him." He said, I don't know what to do." And she went and talked to him. And she went and talked to the pastor and told what had taken place. And the pastor phoned the boy's daddy, Mr. Jackson. And when he heard that his boy was going through this because of what he'd done, then he told the whole thing and brought it all out. And they said, "Well, thank God the boy isn't guilty." And then somebody said, "Where is the boy?" And they went out there in the backyard. To make a long story short, old Tommy just going down the barn, climbed up the rafter with a belt, and he was dead. He was dead. And they had that boy's funeral. They put him out there in the coffin, and the pastor took his Bible and his confirmation papers and put them on top of the coffin and then let the rest of them go by. Now, I don't know what Mrs. Brown and all the big blabbermouths thought that had all the telephones going. You know, a man said one time, he said, "We know the women on the moon because we shot up a communications rocket and it signaled busy." And I don't know what all those folks did that were going those telephone lines up and down that town, but I'll tell you, if I'd walked by the corpse of a boy and knew my big, fat, blabbing mouth had put him there, I might try to get a hold of a case of beer. That tongue is a world of iniquity, brother. Set on fire, hell! And that stuff, if you're tempted to do that stuff, just zip it shut. And then put a little water on it and let it rust. Amen, brother. Amen. And that isn't all about that. And that isn't all about that business. About that tongue business. You know, the thing about that tongue is the more you say, the worse it gets. Did you ever get one of these things where you try to explain something and it's just got more complicated by the minute? And the best thing to do in those cases is just say, if you don't know all the details and you can't see your way through it, you don't know everything involved, just say, "Well, beat the fire out of me, forget it." Or say, "Are the bass running or what, you know?" I tell them sometimes, they get poking around and say, "Well, it's just none of your business." And folks, sometimes that kind of offend them. That's a good way to make a long story short, brother, without getting into it and just dragging that thing on out and out. Your mouth gets you in a mess, you know that? I think about a family visitors came over and visited another certain family, and they came in there and they saw the little girl. And the little girl in this other family came in the room, you know, a little girl about 4 years old, kind of sassy, and she's kind of pushing around the room, and the lady visitor turned to her husband and said, "Oh, she certainly is not a very P-R-E-T-T-Y young lady." And the little girl turned to look right at him and said, That's right, but I'm very S-M-A-R-T. And you say it, you know, and then you say, oh, if I hadn't said it, and it just, you have to stuff the cat back in the bag again. One lie leads to another one, and you have to put this on that, and then that on that, and then this on this, and pretty soon you just got a mountain there. Best thing is just quit. Just shut up. Just don't say nothing. Just stop. A lady, one time, she went to a doctor, and this isn't true either, but it's one of those things, you know, illustrates it. And she went to a doctor, and she said, doctor, she said, I don't know what I'm going to do. My husband's sleeping. And she said, a mouse ran down his throat while he was sleeping. She said, how in the world am I going to get him out? And he said, well, use some cheese. Bait the mouse. So he went back over to the house, you know, about an hour later, and she had a herring, a fish, up in front of his face. And he said, what in the world are you doing that for? She said, I'm trying to get the cat out there that went down after the mouse. Now, you know that's not so. You know that's not so, but you know what that's illustration of? That's just illustration, you know, of this going leading to this, and this leading to this, and this leading to this, and more and more and more, and the thing to do is just shut it up. Just cut it off. Stop it. All right, now the last thing about this business is this. That mouth was made for a purpose, and the purpose, the reason why God gave you a mouth was to praise His name and bear witness and testify. A salesman came by a house one time and cussed the blue streak, you know, dealing with a man at the house. And finally the man said to him, he said, what do you get paid a week? And he told him how much and how much commission. And he said, you work pretty cheap, don't you? And the salesman said, what do you mean by that? He said, well, he said, for a fellow's willing to sell his character and sell his reputation and sell his soul the way you talk, you're working for two small wages. Now, that's the right kind of use for a mouth. And that mouth God gave you was for the purpose of praising God. A man one time, his name was Dunlap up in Carolina. He had a medical doctor, family doctor, very irreverent man, and just cursed every other word. And one time he gave him a little tract called 10 Reasons Why I Swear. You ever seen that thing? They got three of them. One is called 10 Reasons Why I Smoke, 10 Reasons Why I Swear, and 10 Reasons Why I Drink. And they're real good, you know. I believe the first point on 10 Reasons Why I Like to Drink is, I like to vomit. I believe that's the first one on there. And then it goes on there, you know, and says, I like to show, you know, how manly I am, and because this such has such a good effect on women and children, you know, and that kind of business. And he gave one of these little tracts on 10 Reasons Why I Swear, and the doctor didn't contact him for a few weeks. And finally, the doctor phoned up the house there, and he got the message, and he thought, well, he's mad at me. I've offended him, and he was a good doctor. I hate to get another one, but I guess I'll have to. And he found out what the telephone call was, and the telephone call was that doctor. That doctor wanted to get 300 copies of that little tract and pass them out to people he knew. It stopped his swearing and made him a cohorter evangelist for that little old tract, 10 Reasons Why I Don't Swear. Now that fellow there used his mouth right, see? And God gave you a mouth to praise God with, and to pray to God with, and to witness with. And just as sure as the world, when the old mouth, the Christian, is not filled with praise, and not filled with prayer, and not filled with witnessing, then it's filled with something else. That's the great law of life. If a fellow gets saved, and before he's saved, he's used to chewing tobacco, then he better start chewing gum. And before a fellow is saved and gets loaded up on liquor and gets fooling around with liquor, when he drops that liquor, then he better get something else to take its place. And as sure as the world, before a man's saved, if he has one thing that's a great attraction to him and a great temptation to him, like playing drum in a dance band or anything like that, then when he gets saved, he'll have to get something to take the vacuum. And the reason why a lot of grown men never amount to anything for God after they get saved is to live 20, 30, 40 years and get trained, get these habits going. Then when they get saved, they just sit and quit everything and wait for something to happen. You can't do it. There's a vacuum. There's a vacuum. You got to fill the vacuum. You got to pick up something instead of what you did there and fill it up. And this old mouth, you know, that used to say, well, did you ever hear one about the traveling salesman going down the road and standing like the farmer's house? You know that old mouth? That old mouth has got to start learning how to say, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life. That old mouth that used to get up and sing Green Eyes and La Paloma and Tangerine, all that stuff, that mouth better start to learn how to sing, brother, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, a saved wretch like me. And if you played a horn for the devil before you're saved, you better start playing for the Lord after you get saved. You begin something to take its place. And if those old hands and those old fingers were used to painting the wrong kind of things before you were saved, and displaying the flesh before the world, and putting pictures in people's minds and hearts that have no business there, then you better take that hand and get it busy for God, or you'll be right back in the hog wallow again. Now, you see that mouth? You see that tongue? That tongue has served you for years and years and years. And that tongue has got you your way many times just by sheer art, brother, and trickery. And that tongue has supported you and got you through scrapes. And that tongue has promoted you and bragged about you and alibied for you and felt sorry for itself. And that tongue now needs to be put in the service of God. That tongue needs to stop, fell down on the street and say, do you ever read one of these? Give him a tract. Needs to run knocking the door and say, I'm the Brent Baptist Church. You folks ever been out there? Nope. Well, look out if you come. And it should speak. The tongue that God put in my mouth was put there to praise Him with, and that's what it should do. Ask God to make your tongue worthy of the occasion when it opens up. Be like that old colored boy down in Alabama that fell into a big old barrel of molasses in the country store. And when he fell in the barrel of molasses, he said, Lord, he said, make my tongue worthy of this occasion. Get it up. And you pray and say, now, Lord, if you give me an opening out here and give me an occasion to speak, then, Lord, you make me worthy and give my tongue the things to say. There was a fellow out there in the world, his name was Samuel Morse, and he, Morse telegraphy and telegraph, you know. And the Morse code is named after him. That old boy, F.B. Morse, that fellow was, he was one of these fellows that believed the Bible, a saved man. And you know something? When he sent his first message over that telegraph, you know what he sent? He sent, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace, goodwill to men. He put in all three parts, you see, that Kennedy and Pope Paul and Johnson and Eisenhower left out. When Johnson quotes the verse, Johnson always says, peace on earth, goodwill to men. When Pope John and Pope Paul quote it, they say, peace on earth, goodwill to men. When Kennedy had it in his last speech, he said, peace on earth, the men of goodwill, quoting an RSV. But, you know, when Morse said it, you know what he said? He said, glory to God in the highest, off that telegraph. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. And years after he was well up in years, years after he invented the telegraph, some Canadian men got money together, took up a collection, and put a statue up of Morse. And then they got a hold of him on telegraph system and told him what they'd done. And he sat there at that dot dash thing. And when they told him about what they'd done on that thing, he put out four times without saying anything, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget all not his benefits. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget. That's all he can say. See? He just wanted to show his thanks for putting up a statue of him. They talk about a statue of him. All he could put out was, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits come through there. You know what he was doing? He was using his finger to praise God with. And his tongue was down the end of his finger, see, and he's speaking and praising God. God gave you the thing to praise Him with. God gave you the thing to pray with. And God gave you the mouth to witness with. Now, I don't know what that is walking up over the valley over there. I don't know if that's where an overgrown pig or a dog or what it is, because I have a hard time drawing animals, and I don't know what it is. But I know this. I know the big game is over there. And you got no business slaughtering sheep when there's some big game around. That's right. That's right. Don't waste your time shooting at the sheep in the flock when you got something bigger to shoot at. And that tongue should be busy witnessing for the Lord and preaching for the Lord and putting out the word. One time, John R. Rice told of a case where a girl came to him and she said, now, she said, I'm engaged to a young fellow, and said, we've engaged now for about a year and a half, and he wants to get married right away, and all the plans are made. And she said, I'm about to get married. I want to get married. And she said, I really thought I loved him, but she said, I'm finding out real quick that around him and around his people, She said, I can't witness, I can't open my mouth about Jesus Christ. And she said, I'm worried about it. He professed to be saved, but the longer I think about it, I think there must be something wrong there. I don't believe he is saved. But at any rate, I don't have any peace about it. And if I do marry him, she said, I'm going to have to keep my shut around him, around his people. And Brother Rice said, well, what do you think you ought to do? And she said, well, I guess I know what I ought to do, but I just thought maybe I'd get some help, get somebody to take the same side with me. I'm going to have to do it. And back that lady went and took that ring back and gave it back to that boy. As she gave that ring back to that boy, I mean, when the wedding gifts had been bought, and the mamas and daddies were all ready to go on both sides of the family. And they ran out there just crying, just all tore up, just on the verge of suicide. She never did, but she got through, and the Lord blessed her life later. But that girl, they really had something to go through. And you know what she did? She just made up her mind, if I can't take that mouth that God gave me and that tongue and those lips and glorify God and testify for Jesus and raise him up, I just won't have any life. I just won't have any life. Brethren, the tongue is a world of iniquity, set on fire of hell. If a man is able to control the tongue, he's able to control the whole body. And the tongue is the least of the members. The least of the members, but it controls the whole body. If you want to get control, the best control is tongue control. And you can control that, you can control the whole thing. And if you're like me, you know, and I like to speak my conviction, I like to express myself. Just been doing it all my life. Can't do it musically, do it artistically. Can't do it that way with poetry. Can't do it that way, preach. Put the stuff out in paper. Can't do it that way, do some other way. But I've learned one thing in the Lord's work, that God's not going to bless me unless I pick on the big game. And the thing to do is go after the 12-point bucks, brother, and the bear, and the gorillas. And let the mockingbirds and the blue jays and the quail and the dove go when it comes to that stuff, and leave the sheep alone. Leave the sheep alone. Don't be a sheep killer. Don't be a sheep killer. And the most low-down man or woman to face this earth is the person who reached down there and take that old tongue out and dip that thing in the slime of slander and assassinate another Christian character with it. You want to leave it alone. And if you really want to speak up and say something, get you some big game. There's plenty of it around. Woods are full of them. Woods are full of them. Go out after them. All right, let's stand for prayer. Now, Father, we pray that you might forgive us for the sin of backbiting and talking too much and talking about things we have no business talking about. And we know, Father, little people talk about people and big people talk about things and really great people talk about thee. And we pray, Heavenly Father, our conversation might be befitting the gospel of Jesus Christ. We might speak the truth in love. And, Lord, what we know about people, even if it's so, that if it hurt them, we wouldn't want it publicly with our name on it. We'll just leave it alone and forget it. And help us to put it behind us and forget it and let love cover a multitude of sins in all cases. Bless your people here now tonight, Lord, and help them control the tongue, control the minds, and, Lord, give them something to do. Some of them they just need to be busy. Some of them, Lord, have too much time in their hands, and their minds wander. Lord, keep them busy. Give them something to do for thee. Might keep them busy and keep them happy and keep them victorious. And, Lord, help us not to keep our mouth shut and not open it. And in before the adversary, where he needs a word spoken in due season and a word polished like an arrow from the quiver of the master, may Heavenly Father, we be able to speak the truth. May it pierce to the heart and do your work. Bless your people now, Father. Bless our communion service which follows. And may Heavenly Father, you give us a real sense of togetherness and communion here as we celebrate your death and resurrection until you come again. For we ask it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.